The New Zealand Fire Service established its Urban Search and Rescue Team in 1995. We train using the International Search and Rescue Guidelines published by the United Nations. In 2010 and 2011, two large earthquakes in Canterbury called on all of those skills and more. This experience has re-energised our bid to have the team officially classified. The international classification provides assurance to other USAR teams that New Zealand operates under a recognised standard for heavy urban search and rescue. The main purpose of our team is to provide a resource for New Zealand. However, we can provide assistance to countries in the Asia-Pacific region should we be called upon. Obtaining classification is a huge undertaking for our organisation, but it will be worth it as we refine our approach and increase our capability across the range of skills required.
The New Zealand Fire Service has invested heavily in its urban search and rescue team's capability and training. We want to be sure we are ready to be assessed by the United Nations for international external classification in March 2015. There are 202 people in the team. 160 are firefighters, as well as 10 engineers, 18 medics, 10 dog handlers, and 4 doctors. USAR teams operate in many countries, and like the New Zealand Task Force, they are called on to rescue people trapped in different types of accidents or natural disasters. These can include building or structural collapses, industrial accidents, landslides, floods, and earthquakes. The team's technicians are trained to shore up buildings and use a range of heavy tools and cutting gear to safely extract people from difficult or confined spaces. Our team is different to many other countries because its members are drawn from across New Zealand, not just from one city or region. For an international deployment, personnel from outside Auckland would be flown in to assemble at the Northern USAR base behind the Auckland City Fire Station. This base holds the international equipment cache and is where pre-deployment processing would be carried out. This includes passport checks, a final medical checkup, collection of personal kit, and a briefing about the mission. In a real-life situation, this would take 2 to 3 hours. The task force and its cache would then leave for the airport, where there is a final briefing before takeoff. The USAR team has a memorandum of understanding with the New Zealand Defence Force and Air New Zealand to support an international deployment. The first USAR team that arrives in a disaster-affected country coordinates the arrival and establishment of other USAR teams and manages the first wave of humanitarian aid. They do this by setting up a reception departure centre at the airport and an on-site operations coordination centre, or OSOC, at the disaster scene.
Do you have any information?
The USAR management team have completed a United Nations course on the procedures for setting up and managing a reception and departure centre and an on-site operations coordination centre. The job of those at the reception departure centre is to check the credentials of incoming USAR teams, make sure they are self-sufficient for 10 days, and assign them a disaster worksite or dispatch them to the OSOC. The OSOC liaises with the USAR teams and the local emergency management agency to exchange information and coordinate the use of local resources, such as heavy lifting equipment, transportation, timber, and fuel. The OSOC also coordinates the incoming aid. Once the United Nations Disaster Assessment and Coordination personnel arrive, they take leadership of the OSOC, and the USAR team then focus solely on the search and rescue effort. We recently held a major exercise at one of our USAR training sites, a derelict freezing works near Palmerston North. A task force of 71 USAR personnel were put through their paces over 36 hours. This was a test of our processes for a full national or international deployment, which included setting up a reception departure centre, on-site operations coordination centre, a base of operations, and practicing a wide range of search and rescue skills. One One of the first tasks of an arriving USAR team is to set up their base of operations. This is both their headquarters and their home for the duration of the deployment. The entire base, from showers to whiteboards, is flown in with the team and it can be operational within 4 hours of arriving. While most of the team are setting up the base, others are out inspecting bridges, finding a safe route to collapsed buildings, and assessing them. They also liaise with the local emergency management authority to determine what their priorities are, so rescues can begin as soon as possible. Fire service staff spent several weeks preparing the training site for this exercise, with elaborately built scenarios imitating the effects of buildings that have collapsed, leaving people trapped in voids. USAR technicians shore up structures and access points, tunnel their way through concrete and rubble to find, treat, and stabilise victims before bringing them to safety. It was an exhausting 36 hours. However, the team received excellent feedback from the Queensland USAR team leaders, who have been our official mentors throughout the international external classification process. And it doesn't end there. New Zealand USAR continues to train throughout the year, and members are always on standby, ready to respond to any national or international disaster requiring their specialist skills.